thank you very much for coming along once again to Eco Views and News. This evening we're going to be working on this question of a huge meeting that's occurring now in South Africa. Basically, there's a meeting of the Conference of Parties, that's known as a COP, or Conference of Parties, which is the meeting of all of the members who have signed the Kyoto Protocol, plus a few like the United States who haven't signed it, but seem to want to be in on the action anyway. And that may be one of the problems, because the United States seems to have a lot to say about issues that it's not really a signatory to as an international treaty. And for this reason, a lot of people are raising objections. But we'll want to look at the context in which this is taking place. So I refer to it as climate talks in two ways here, both extreme weather that we've been experiencing on a global scale and the urgent meetings in South Africa. From Southern California to Durban, South Africa, we're going to look at the range of things, because just this last week we've had an extraordinary set of exceptional weather events. The mainstream media carries this from time to time, and you've seen it, 150 mile per hour winds in the Santa Ana phenomena on the West Coast, and ABC News carried this report on it, which is pretty striking at the time.
Out of those fierce winds tearing through the West, several cities have declared emergencies and are still cleaning up after a very rough night. ABC's David Wright is in Pasadena, California for us this morning. Good morning, David.
Good morning, Robin. It has been an unbelievable 24 hours here. A windstorm causing the sort of damage you normally see in an earthquake. Millions of people dodging tree trunks on the way to work. That's if work was open. A lot of small businesses, even some big movie studios, have been closed because for so many people, the power is out. In Utah, it looked like the center of a tornado. Across the west and into the night Thursday, high winds tossing 18-wheelers, toppling gigantic trees.
Bam! Oh, it's hitting me barely missed the ground.
And crushing car after car with uprooted trunks.
It's insane. I've seen like probably 100 trees down, blocking entire streets, like block after block after block.
The latest Santa Ana windstorm to wallop the West Coast is the strongest in more than a decade. In the mountains, wind speeds topped 150 miles per hour, the force of a Category 4 hurricane.
I have never in 36 years seen anything like this out here.
Overnight, crews worked to restore power to more than 300,000 people in California alone, leaving many without gas pumps, ATMs, and restaurants. In Los Angeles, a state of emergency Thursday. More than a dozen schools closed. Students celebrating a rare wind day.
That's cool.
Here in Pasadena, this heap of twisted metal is all that's left after a tree collapsed on the roof of a gas station. Trees and traffic signals blocked roadways for miles. The storm spread across the west from the coast to northern Utah. These students at Weber University barely able to make it up the stairs.
What force of winds could possibly take down all these trees?
So many downed trees here, residents were actually trapped inside their homes.
We couldn't even get out. We had to like crawl through trees. We thought it was going to come through the house.
As of this morning, still more than a quarter million people without power, and the cleanup continues. And it may not be over yet. High wind advisories remain in effect through this afternoon.
Well, you can see the problem here. It's really quite dramatic. We in the East Coast haven't seen any of this, so we don't realize what a crisis it is. But the Santa Ana winds in Southern California have had an extraordinary impact here and are convincing a lot about extreme weather these days. There is also a series of things that have occurred elsewhere in the world, and oddly enough, or ironically enough, and sadly enough, right on the eve of the other kinds of climate talks, not just the climate talking, in a sense, with extreme weather, but the climate talks that are taking place in Durban, South Africa, between the meetings of the parties. The Conference of Parties, as it's called, COP17, is taking place in South Africa And Amy Goodman had an excellent essay podcast up on the web. You probably heard it. It's called Cry the Beloved Climate. And she reflects on this extreme weather series of events in South Africa just on the eve of this conference. Take a listen here. It's pretty extraordinary.
Cry the Beloved Climate. I'm Amy Goodman, host of Democracy Now! With my weekly Breaking the Sound Barrier podcast. The United Nations annual climate summit descended on Durban, South Africa this week, but not in time to prevent the tragic death of Kudeni Simba. The 17-year-old was one of 10 people killed in Durban Sunday, the night before the UN conference opened. Torrential rains pummeled the seaside city of 3.5 million. 700 homes were destroyed by the floods. Simba was sleeping when the concrete wall next to her collapsed. One woman tried to save a flailing one-year-old baby whose parents had been crushed by their home. She failed. The baby died along with both parents. All this as more than 20,000 politicians, bureaucrats, journalists, scientists, and activists made their way to what may be the last chance for the Kyoto Protocol. How might the conference have prevented the deaths? A better question is, how might the massive deluge, which fell on the heels of other deadly storms this month, be linked to human-induced climate change? And what is the gathering in Durban doing about it? Durban has received twice the normal amount of rain in November. The trends suggest extreme weather is going to get worse. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is a group with thousands of scientists who volunteer their time to provide the world with a clear scientific view on the current state of knowledge in climate change. The group won the Nobel Peace Prize in 2007. Last week, the IPCC released a summary of its findings, clearly linking changing climate to extreme weather events such as drought, flash floods, hurricanes, heat waves, and rising sea levels. The World Meteorological Organization released a summary of its latest findings, noting to date 2011 is the 10th warmest year on record, that the Arctic sea ice is at its all-time low volume this year, and that 13 of the warmest years on record have occurred in the past 15 years. Which brings us to Durban. This is the 17th conference of the parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, or simply COP17. One of the signal achievements of the UN process to date is the Kyoto Protocol, an international treaty with enforceable provisions designed to limit greenhouse gas emissions. In 1997, when Kyoto was adopted, China was considered a poor developing country and as such had far fewer obligations under Kyoto. Now the U.S. and others say that China must join the wealthy developed nations and comply with that set of rules. China refuses. That's one of the major, but by no means the only, stumbling blocks to renewing the Kyoto Protocol. Another major problem is that the world's historically largest polluter, the United States, signed Kyoto but did not ratify it in Congress. In Copenhagen in late 2009, at COP15, President Obama swept in, organized backdoor invite-only meetings, and crafted a voluntary, i.e. unenforceable, alternative to Kyoto, angering many. COP16 in Cancun, Mexico in 2010 heightened the distance from the Kyoto Protocol. The prevailing wisdom in Durban is that this is make-or-break time for the UN climate process. Exacerbating Obama's failures is the Republican majority in the House of Representatives that largely holds human-made climate change as being either a hoax or simply non-existent, as do 8 of the 9 Republican presidential candidates. Oil and gas corporations spend tens of millions of dollars annually to promote junk science and climate change deniers. Their investment has paid off, with an increasing percentage of Americans believing climate change is not a problem. Coincident with the disappointing UN proceedings has been a growing movement for climate justice in the streets. Protests against fossil fuel dependence, which accelerates global warming, range from the nonviolent direct action against mountaintop removal coal mining in West Virginia to the arrest of more than 1,200 people at the White House opposing the Keystone XL tar sands oil pipeline. Which is why Durban, South Africa, is such a fitting place for civil society to challenge the United Nations process. The continent of Africa is projected to experience the impact of climate change more severely than many other locales, and most populations here are less well equipped to deal with climate disasters without proper infrastructure or a reserve of wealth to deploy.
So you can see the tension here. The crisis is going to hit Africa more severely than other parts of the world and more swiftly. It already has. It did on the eve of the opening of these conferences. Or the conference meetings. And yet it seems as though the United States and others are pulling back from the commitments that they promised would be part of the package to renew Kyoto from 2012 forward. The United States is even questionable about whether it's going to support the idea of going forward with a global climate treaty. So it's tension that's going to show up in the streets this week in Kyoto, in Durban, about the Kyoto Protocol.
Yet these are the people who threw off the oppressive yoke of apartheid. South African novelist Alan Paton wrote of apartheid in 1948, the system's first year, anticipating a long fight to overturn it. Cry the beloved country. These things are not yet at an end. The same determination is growing in the streets of Durban, providing the leadership so lacking in the air-conditioned enclave of COP17. I'm Amy Goodman with Dennis Moynihan.
Okay, well, you can see this is going to be the theme, the tension between what's going on in the conference houses or the House of Conference Delegates and what's going on the streets among people who are gathering from all over the world. Some of this has been reported by Al Jazeera, and you should take a look because they have a very subtle understanding of what's going on here. More so
not
than
just
a lot
the
of the American press.
Japan, Canada, and the United States in the developed world standing in the way of a long-term deal. It's also the likes of China, India, and even South Africa.
Now, this is interesting. Let's take it back to the beginning of their report, because South Africa obviously wants these accords and this meeting to be a success.
At the first major climate summit on African soil, the seeds of an African revolt. This is what could become known as Occupy Durban, a pan-African campaign demanding action on climate change.
At stake is the livelihoods of the people. At stake is the survival of humanity. At stake is our food. Our granaries have run out. There is no rainfall.
Largely invisible to the rich world, Africa is worst hit by the effects of climate change, from floods to drought and famine. Changing seasons and longer heat waves have disrupted farming, turning marginal areas to desert, making cities unbearably hot. The rich world has ignored the interests of the poor at summits past, they say. Not this time.
This is resistance to the changing politics of climate change. No longer is it simply a fight of the rich against the poor. It's now a contest of the strong versus the weak. And it's not just the likes of Japan, Canada, and the United States in the developed world standing in the way of a long-term deal. It's also the likes of China, India, and even South Africa.
Some here question South Africa's ability to be an effective host of the Durban talks.
In signing the Copenhagen Accord 2 years ago, Jacob Zuma, one of the five main signatories, legitimized the U.S. position, which is to destroy the Kyoto Protocol. I fear that's what this government's going to allow Durban to be known for. The Kyoto Protocol ends, and this is just a conference of polluters.
We are the people!
So the African summit takes place on a continent divided. Activists here will risk arrest in gatherings and marches like this. And there have been calls for diplomatic sit-ins and boycotts inside the conference itself. This African summit, they hope, will not ignore demands for change, but precedent suggests it just might. Jonah Hull, Al Jazeera, Durban.
Well, you can see the problem. The precedent of these failed conferences suggests that this too might collapse, in effect, with no accord, no agreement. Both among the COP members, that is the Conference of Parties, and the United States, to go forward with an obligation after Kyoto lapses in 2012. The United States has a very complex position, and it's been covered by some in the conference, but you ought to take a look at the range of different things that are coming out now, in a way. Here's one summary of the U.S. position. Take a look.
Alex, you've come out of the... Alex, you watched the U.S. press conference today. What would you say the U.S. position is at the start of these talks?
Well, there are two major issues that I think were discussed in the press conference and that are really important at the Durban climate talks right now. The first is the Kyoto Protocol. That's the current emissions treaty that we have right now, and whether there's going to be another successor treaty to the Kyoto Protocol that's legally binding. The second issue is the Green Climate Fund, the fund that was set up last year in Cancun, and whether they'll actually be able to operationalize that fund and whether they will have some money that actually flows through the fund.
Okay, so let's start with the Kyoto Protocol. What did the U.S. negotiators have to say on this?
Well, first of all, the U.S. isn't actually part of the Kyoto Protocol. It was never actually ratified in the Senate, although it was signed. So it's not bound by the Kyoto Protocol, and the U.S. negotiators have basically said they're not interested in joining it, and whatever happens in the negotiations on that side, really none of our business. We can't really influence the outcome, essentially.
But there's people are working towards a new treaty or a bigger treaty. That's the hope. What do the U.S. want out of that?
Well, the U.S. has put up some preconditions to whether they would become part of a future legally binding treaty that a lot of developing countries and emerging economies like China and India have basically said are red lines, and that that's not the kind of treaty that they can join in. So there's kind of an impasse there about what that treaty would look like. Two different visions.
Okay. Where's the impasse? What are the red lines that they're not prepared to cross?
I think essentially the issue is that there are emitters, developed countries that are historical emitters, and they're mostly responsible for the greenhouse gases that are currently in the atmosphere. So, you know, the United States, the EU, historically responsible for climate change. On the other hand, there are these emerging economies, especially China, Brazil, South Africa, India, who are developing and emitting more and more. China is actually the number one greenhouse gas emitter today. And so those countries are saying, we're not historically responsible for this, we're still developing, dealing with a lot of issues around poverty. We shouldn't have to agree to legally binding cuts that are as large as these historically responsible emitters like the United States.
Okay, so you can see the tension between who's created the problem and who's supposed to clean it up. Now, clearly, everyone should engage in cleaning it up, but the Kyoto Protocol had some very specific language about what was called common, that is, everyone had a common responsibility, but differentiated responsibilities. And the differentiation had to do with the historically guilty parties, in some sense. It's as if China and India were saying, fine, let's play with everyone else, and let's pay the taxes on the use of carbon. But first, before we do, let's look at who owes the back taxes for having used carbon up until now, in the sense of having emitted carbon into the atmosphere since the Industrial Revolution, since 1750. Okay, you guys pay the back taxes, and we'll be glad to pay taxes from now on in with everyone else. But if you think we can just start now and everyone has to constrain themselves, the deal's not on, you know? That's not understanding the common but differentiated responsibilities. So here's the impasse that it's reached at this point, and we'll have to see if it can, that Durban can get beyond it. It's not clear that it can. I mean, this is not a foregone conclusion. On the streets, there are, in effect, demands for climate action that have a lot more to do with the Occupy movements that have started to emerge around the world. Take a look at some of this. This is pretty interesting.
Steve, thanks for joining us. Do you want to give us an idea of what's going on here?
Basically, we've gathered as part of the people's movements to discuss what we feel are going to be real solutions to climate change, which are ones that focus on removing fossil fuels from our economy and looking at a people-centered solution that focuses on the rights of Mother Nature.
And how is this going to, you know, what's this going to result in? How's this going to scale up into action around the world? How are we seeing this manifest itself?
Well, I think what we're seeing around the world is a disillusionment with the processes and economics that we've seen up to this point. People are starting to react against what has been your dominant paradigm for the last 50 years. And unrepresentative governments and corporations and institutions are now facing the fact that people, the 99%, want to be heard, and they want to make their solutions. They want to participate in the democracy. They don't want to vote once every 4 years and then have governments that don't do anything or, you know, deliver on their promises. So what we're trying to do here is, in solidarity with the Occupy movements that are happening around the world and the Indignados and a lot of the Arab Spring, is facilitate that conversation and see how we can bring together movement with climate justice perspective. Because it's the same struggle, essentially.
Okay, it's the same sort of struggle, essentially, that is moving beyond the Occupy movements to the next step politically, is basically looking at solutions that will create jobs, not just feed the bankers for what's gone wrong in the past, and in effect create a new kind of economy. This is what is being suggested here. This isn't the only example of it. In fact, the 350.org, Bill McKibben's group that sort of demonstrated in front of the White House, was well present there, and Diana has given a very articulate statement about what ought to be going on. In addition, Martin Kaur has been talking about why it is the development fund that was mentioned briefly is not adequate. Take a look at this.
Well, on the danger that the funds will go to the international private sector, the developing countries had thought that the Green Climate Fund would be a fund that would have windows to directly fund the developing countries for adaptation and mitigation. But many developed countries, during the discussion at the Transitional Committee, insisted on having a private sector window or facility. Now, originally the thinking was that the private sector would then contribute money to the fund, which would be very welcome. But the way the report is worded, you'll find that it is actually the fund that will be providing money to the private sector.
Okay. Well, the whole thing is seeming to be behind the scenes, rigged to be working exactly the opposite. As it should. Governments may contribute to a common fund, but where's that fund going to go? It was supposed to go to the developing countries to help adapt to climate change. But it now looks like behind the scenes, several big actors like the United States want that money to be made available to the private sector. So it's taking money from governments in the North and giving it back to the private sector entrepreneurs in the North. Well, you can see the third world delegations are quite irritated about this and not about to let it happen. So that's another source of tension in all of this. And you can see that beyond that, there are some street demonstrations. People like Komi Naidoo, who's now the head of the, basically the Greenpeace International, have made forceful statements about what ought to be happening.
Kimmy, you're in your home city today. What are you calling for with this march?
We're basically saying that the negotiations are not going anywhere. There's a lack of ambition, a lack of urgency, and this march is really about trying to bring a message of sanity, a message of urgency to the ministers that are arriving today at the end of the first week of the negotiations. So right now, if we leave Durban with the Kyoto being buried here, it will be a betrayal of our children and grandchildren's future. But more importantly, we need to ensure that we lay the foundation for a fair, ambitious and legally binding treaty right here and get on beyond talking to investing in a green economy, to shift away from fossil fuels, but also to do it in a way that is good for the environment, but also good for jobs, good for poverty and good for peace and security in the future.
Okay, on the appeal of listen to the people, not the polluters, the logic is we've got to get serious about these talks. And he's making the case in a way for this on the street. Now, Komi Naidoo, you should know, he's head of Greenpeace International, but he's a Rhodes Scholar from South Africa. And he spent a lot of time skirting the South African government in the anti-apartheid struggle. He's had a lot of experience in struggles in one way or another in this sense. Now, we're fortunate that this next week, the COP17 United Nations Climate Conference is going to be covered by Amy in South Africa. She's got a team down there, and the final week is going to be covered by that team. So we're going to have a lot of rich interviews and see what's in fact happening here. But keep in touch about the extreme weather, the urgent meetings, and how climate is talking, how we are talking about it, and how it's happening, too. Keep in touch on air or online.